den Trailer haben wir gehört, aber nicht gesehen. Aber wir starten jetzt und schauen jetzt auf eine Smart City in Dänemark, genauer gesagt in Kopenhagen, und haben den Programmmanager persönlich zugeschaltet. Er koordiniert als Programmmanager intelligente Regionen, Programme und Projekte für intelligente Städte, um eine umweltfreundlichere und innovativere Stadt mit besserer Lebensqualität für die Menschen konkret in Kopenhagen zu entwickeln. A very warm welcome, Henrik Johansson, den Smart City Program Manager von Capital Region of Denmark. Nice to have you here.
Thank you very much. I will just share my screen to show my presentation. But I'm delighted to be here to tell you a little bit about the smart city journey we've been on in the capital region of Denmark. I could just quickly start out by telling you a little bit about who is the capital region. It's a political organization where we have politicians, which is elected, and we have a council who actually decides upon what we are going to do at the regional level. It's a position between the state and the cities, and we are actually one of the largest working places in Denmark with 45,000 employees. But the regional department where I work is only a minor part and only 10% of the overall company. And our budget is around 800 million Danish kroners. And much of this funding is used for the mobility area. We have a regional strategy to develop all kinds of areas we have mandate within. And this only comes with about 10 to 12 million Danish kroners. So that's not very much. And smart city is only a part of this. So this means that when we do projects, we actually need partners very much to be able to finance our projects. Moreover, we are a part of what is called Greater Copenhagen, which also includes two regions in south of Sweden and Skåne, and the region south of the capital region. So all in all, we add up to about 4.3 million citizens in the Greater Copenhagen area. And we have 85 municipalities, where the capital city are only 29 of them. The mandate of the capital region is to handle hospitals in the health area, environmental issues, climate, traffic, mobility, and education. And if I should just look a bit into our burning platform, what do we actually try to solve? It is probably like many other European cities that we try to have some ambitious goal regarding the green agenda, and we try to reduce CO2 emissions by 70%. But we also have all these challenges from radar conditions where we need to be more resilient. More and more people moving towards the cities would mean larger energy consumption, but also challenges with mobility and so on. And this is more or less what the smart city channels is going to look into. We just recently launched a new regional development strategy. And not that I will go much into this here, but we have some certain specific goals within the sectoral areas. And then we have these tools I pointed one out called innovation, which I will just go on to the next slide, which kind of is a principle that when we try to solve challenges, we have to take advantages of new opportunities there are in digitalization, use of technology and data. But the thing here is that we try not to focus on the technology, but much more focusing on solving the real challenges we have in front of us. As a technology enthusiast, I must say that I'm maybe not strictly happy about that the technology haven't got a stronger focus. But I think with the wind, new trends, how it blows, tech comes in and out of strategies. And no matter what, of course, as an administration, you need to do something about the technology transformation, because the citizen would expect that of us. So that doesn't mean we can sit at our hands. But in the region, we just recently had a reorganization where we created this cross-cutting development department consisting on several of our sectoral areas, where we have to kind of harvest some of the synergies there are between working across the sector. So for instance, when we solve some mobility challenges, this should also help reduce CO2 emissions and help the climate, which again could help health issues and so on. But when it comes to the technology focus, we switch more and more to this to be a part where we develop new solutions in partnerships, and we gather some of the competences for this, cooperate with the business sector to work on solving these real challenges that is the main focus in our organization as a public sector. But just to go a bit back in history, how did we actually arrive at this state on our smart city journey from back earlier on? If I switch back to 2015, when I started my work in the capital region, we were more or less just coming out of this hype on big data, where everyone knew that there was huge amounts of value if we just started using data. And in our region, Copenhagen City was doing some quite interesting projects, which was a front runner also worldwide. But besides that, it was mainly some entrepreneurs in smaller cities who did some use cases or demonstration projects, which was quite interesting. Besides that, most of the cities actually didn't know anything about what smart city was or how to use data or whatever. So this was more or less where we started with our new strategy, where we had smart growth as a focus area within other areas, which I won't tell so much about here. But within the smart growth area, we try to focus in on basically five pillars. The first one was with the strategy to kind of gather our different kind of actors in the region around a common vision for the overall region. Moreover, we would look into how could we start up initiatives on data so we could get a hold of some of these values that we thought was hiding in these data. Moreover, of course, talking about these big data, we needed an infrastructure who could actually have the capacity to handle these huge amounts of data. So we would initiate some project focusing on mobile connections, broadband cables, but also infrastructure for sensors on these low frequency digital infrastructure connections. Moreover, we knew that we have to think privacy and security from the start to protect the data from the citizens' data. And we were also going to make sure that when we built solutions, it could not suddenly be hacked. For instance, a sensor solution for controlling traffic. Suddenly, if it would be hacked, you could lay down a whole traffic system. And in this strategy, we had this dream of creating a regional data hub. But the idea of what this was could be different things. First of all, we had this idea that it actually could be a physical place where we gathered some partners, where we could sit and work together in a co-working space. But it could also be a partnership where we would work together with a lot of different sectors and competence areas, and also cooperate with companies between public sector, between universities in what we call triple helix partnerships. And then we had this idea, if within the different sectors, for instance, mobility, we could have this development of a cluster with competences within technologies of this area. It could be the same within energy, work with data in general, and so on. But all of this could then link into a center where we could gather some of the competence to work with this, work on shared tools for this, visualization platforms, and so on. Because we knew from many of the reports at that time, for instance, McKinsey and so on, who predicted that we would really lack many of these resources working with technology and so on. So we did some analysis, and what came out of this was basically to build a smart city house. And the idea for this is, if you are a tech person, you would know it's something like an simple model of an enterprise architecture. But we would have this basic structure, which would consist of all the connecting networks, mobile, broadband, and digital infrastructure, and so on. We would have this middle layer where we would test and demonstrate, have data platforms, and so on. And then we would have these cross-cutting activities where we would work on digital skills, security and privacy, and methods for developing new solutions. And these two layers below should then kind of support the layer on top, where you have all the sectors, areas, and the actual problems we are going to solve. And this again should play into the public vision and strategies. So this was kind of the basic start when we started out back in 2015. And in this thinking, we in 2016 launched a platform, a marketplace for city data. It was a project that came out of a dialogue together with the city of Copenhagen and some other partners about harvesting some of these values in big data. So eventually, Hitachi won this tender to build a platform for city data. And the idea was that now we, as a start, had some platforms for public data. We have this platform, Open Data DK, which is shared among cities, regions, and the state is also beginning to work with us on this common shared platform, where we can put out data so companies can use these data to create smart solutions for the citizens. And the idea was, now we have all these public data, so of course we also need to have a private data place. So companies can put their data up for sale, and then the idea was that suddenly we would see companies coming to the region to work with all these data made available for free. But it didn't happen like that at all. Actually, quite early it showed that many of the companies, they were quite concerned about privacy and security, so they wouldn't actually put up the data on the platform. Moreover, when we were going to solve actual problems, we found out that you actually needed quite specific data. So, for instance, if you want to say something about citizens in a local square, it doesn't matter if you have ticketing data or data about cars moving in the street, because then you have to have the data relevant for actually being able to give meaning to this problem. And what eventually showed that the success with this was that Microsoft put together a team who worked a lot on contacting different kind of partners to see if they could find data needed for solving certain kind of problems. So this actually didn't need the platform at all, because then you could, in smaller partnership, develop solutions and you could share data in a more trusted place. So eventually it turned out that the platform was a pretty bad business, and it was quite expensive to run each month. So in 2018, it was already decided to close the platform down. But we learned quite a lot from this project. And together with this, we were having some discussion with politicians and experts joining in roundtables to discuss how could a smart Greater Copenhagen look like in the future. And there were pretty strong agreement about that the citizens should be at the center. Not that this is very surprising. We have in the last year have this development where we focus in on what is value for the citizen and don't waste public money. But what can be challenging is that if technology or tech is seen as a black box, this I think is quite dangerous, because when we develop solutions, and especially if we have the citizen at the center, we need also to think about the effect technologies have on the citizen. So this also means that it's important to move ahead with a political framework. So you need to have some organization who put things together, so you have the involvement of the politicians and the decision makers, so they actually knew that this is not just a black box, it actually can mean something about how we work and how we interact with the citizens. And this process, it's also necessary that we actually have someone who knows about the tech. We have something who actually tells something about what can the solutions do for us. And this means also that we have to involve both top and bottom, because if we come with some solutions for technical people to handle and they resist using these, it will not be a success. So this is some of the strong learnings we have. And what I see is kind of we are still on a process where we change from the industrial society, where we have one decision maker at the top and the rest of us working for this guy at the top, and changing more and more into a network society, which is much more complex and difficult. And as a public sector, usually we doesn't go this change around by a big bang, but take one small step at the time. Maybe situations like Corona could speed things up a bit, but that's the situation. If I should just tell you a bit about our data journey, we more or less have had a lot of initiatives, starting with the state putting some basic data available to the cities, opening up their data on platform to. We cooperate with cities to, we had the city data exchange and moving on to some other projects I will tell you about in a second. But the idea is that we've been linking and coordinating projects and programs, and this has been quite successful for us, because that means that some of the successful projects actually move forward. So if I just should wrap up a bit of some of the learnings from the history so far, it is that we definitely should not focus on platform and technology, but much more on the problem we are going to solve and the people we are going to involve. And this is going to be around the use case. So that's where we start. And when we have a success there, we need to have this resource commitment for use case. And from there, we could scale, but also begin to look into, when we have more solution, how could these be linked together? So we start looking into ecosystem and actually back to developing platforms. That's the road we are on, but still the raw resource commitment is still difficult, and we haven't yet totally cracked the knot on this. We have loads of projects we started since 2015. I won't go into all of them, but just tell we've been focusing in on these five pillars I spoke about. And if you want to know more, you could just feel free to contact me to know more about some of the projects. But one project I think you should know a bit about is our flagship, the Regional Data Hub. And that's coming out of the dream we had back in 2015. And with this project, actually Smart City became concrete. We now have 20 cities working together to solve challenges by data within mobility, climate, and city operation. And this project also links to other projects. And what's been really successful in this is that we have a steering group which consists of decision makers from several of the partners in the project, mainly from the cities. Advisory boards with experts where we could look into to challenges and how to move ahead, basically from companies and universities. And then we had these working groups, a network of this with the actually technicians who are going to use the solutions afterwards. The steering group have so far pointed out 5 for further tests. Not that I will go so much into this, but just tell that here it's necessary to have a strong business case to be able to scale a project. For instance, we had this sensor solution to make better use of facilities. It's easy to scale cities jumping on the project because easily they could save money by using building much more efficiently. But other use cases like road capacity, predictions of traffic patterns, water flows and so on is more difficult because the value proposition is much more complex. You cannot just put two partners together. The public sector has a problem and just buy a solution, at least not in Denmark. You need more partners to be able to have return on investment to make this work. And if just to tell you a bit about one of our solutions, we had been using cars from data, floating car data, to steer traffic lights. And with this project, we demonstrated that actually gives much faster traveling time, less waste of time and reduction in CO2. And if we would scale this project to a national level, it would actually mean we would save a lot of money and CO2 emissions. But still, again, it's difficult to scale such a project. And that means it's relevant to include both the top and the bottom in this, so they are coming along all the way. And you have all the partners to scale the problem or the use case. And it has paid out for us because now, for instance, the mobility people in the capital region, they have started a project where they try to develop intelligent traffic light systems. We have Doll Living Lab, which is the largest lab for smart city technologies in the real city space, where we have loads of solutions being demonstrated. And in this lab, they are now putting up a system for traffic light where they would test different kind of management systems and solutions for controlling traffic much more easily. But the idea is that we actually, with these projects, level some of the competences and the knowledge which was lacking some years back. And if I should finally just wrap up the journey we've been on, is that no doubt about that the smart city, it gives cost savings and better use of resources and the city service. But no one can do this alone. You need to partner up. You need to get into this new networking or economy, which is based much more on partnership, which means you commit some resources, but that also means you give up some responsibility for deciding your area for yourself. It takes leadership to scale if you haven't involved the one who actually are going to invest in a solution. It won't work. And moreover, you need to involve the technical people which are actually going to use the solution, because if they are going to have a gift they're not interested in, it won't be a success. And then also this about failing, it gives a lot of knowledge moving forward. As for us, starting with the platform, which wasn't a success, but with the use case and build things up along the way we go. So that was a bit about our smart city story in Greater Copenhagen. I have much more to tell, but maybe you have a few questions so I could dig a bit into a few other things.
Yeah, but thank you very much for this inspiring and very exciting speech. And we have only time for one question, I think, because we are over the time. I have a question here from our chat, and there, you said at the beginning, much of our funding is used for mobility. Why is it used for mobility? Is that an area in Denmark specially focused on?
Oh, once again, the financing is... I can't hear you. There's no sound. Your sound is off. I think I heard something about you asked about the financing. And as I said, we didn't completely crack the nut on how to finance smart city projects. But one success story we have is that we have a partner organization where a lot of members for both private and public companies get together to work on problems. It's a member of an organization where, for instance, we could put up a new secretariat where the funding would be kind of a membership. And we do that with the regional data hub moving ahead. We will have a common or shared secretariat where everyone would kind of bid in on the project. But of course, we also look into the funding available at national and EU level and so on to have additional funding. But eventually, of course, this has to be able to live by itself. But we are not there yet. Thanks. I don't know if that was the right answer to the question.
Right. But, and nobody hears me. I smile. Henrik, I think you answered to my question. I don't hear anything, but the time says we are at the end of our talk. So I think I say thank you very much for your speech. Do you hear me?
You're welcome. Yeah,
okay.
I hear you.
Thank you very much. And I think we had a lot of input from Denmark. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for inviting me.